Today on Real Life, what is your definition of beauty? The ladies of Mom Talk share what the Bible has to say. And speaking of looks, do you feel like you put on some pounds from that Easter dinner? Well, the Sherwoods break down on how to cut down on excess fat. And Tim Burgan is back with a special announcement about nightlife. You don't want to miss it. All that and so much more right now on Real Life.
This is Real Life. God loves you. Jesus died for you. The Holy Spirit, He empowers you. And the Bible is your and my guide to abundant life. I'm J. Anthony Gilbert, and as you can see, Don and Terry are off today traveling, doing what they do. But you know what? God is still on the throne, and they never leave us empty-handed because we've got the great Pastor Amy Chafee today.
And the great Jay Gilbert. Yeah,
so
nice
good to
see
be back
you.
With you.
Yes. Okay, we're just coming off of Easter weekend, which is kind of a big deal for churches, right?
It is.
Because we have the CEO Christians, the Christmas, Easter, and other Christians.
That's right, that's
so
right.
So it's really like a Super Bowl Sunday for the local church. How did your weekend go?
You know what? We had a true Resurrection Sunday. It was an awesome time. You know what I love about ministry is you just don't know what God's going to do. Just like today, anything can happen in this moment. Whenever you have expectancy, it's the breeding ground for miracles.
Right.
And anything can take place. And our church came in expecting, ready for God to move. And we had a flood of souls that came in that day. I was getting ready to take up the offering. The Holy Ghost fell. We had 8 and 9-year-olds coming to the altar, weeping in the presence of God. New families, whole families holding their babies, coming up, giving their life to Jesus.
Right.
And so we had a true Resurrection Sunday. How
about
you?
That's awesome. Yes. Souls saved by the droves. Kids coming in.
Amen.
Young adults, young Marys. And here's the cool thing about the resurrection. It's all about Jesus. It's all about the blood. And if you think in one moment, we stand before God free and forgiven because of the price that Jesus paid for us. So all of those years of sinning, all of those years of pain and hurt, in one instance, in one moment, when we receive Christ, everything changes. And it's the coolest thing about the gospel.
Amen. If any man be in Christ,
he's
a new creation. Old things have passed away, and all has become new. You know what I love about Resurrection Sunday, too, is that it's always a reminder of no matter how dark it is, no matter what we're going through, we're always promised another day.
Right.
Resurrection power is inside of our lives.
Right.
And those of you that are out there right now, I want you to realize, even though Easter might be past, we need to remember resurrection each and every day. I don't care what you're going through today, what you're experiencing, what's going on in your life, the power of God is available for you today. Mm-hmm. And all throughout this show, what's great is we have prayer partners that are always standing by. 888-665-4483. Call in at any time. Mm-hmm. We're here to pray with you, to believe God with you. And I just love the fact that God is always on the move. There's anything can happen at any moment when you're serving God.
I like that idea, Jay, that resurrection power is not just for Easter Sunday.
That's right.
It's Monday morning, Tuesday afternoon, Wednesday evening, Thursday during the day when you're struggling with those deep struggles of maybe a divorce, maybe an addiction, maybe it's something that you've pushed aside that nobody knows about but you and God. Well, that same resurrection power can help you rise up out of that really darkness and entrapment, because the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy from you. So whatever he's trying to do to steal from your life, to steal the joy, to steal the peace, guess what? That resurrection power can help you rise above. And he is with us at all times, every day.
Amen. And for those of you that are CEO Christians, Christmas and Easter only, go to church.
Yeah.
Go to church this Sunday. Go back to church. God's got so much that he wants to do, and he's always moving in your life. Put yourself in position to receive a miracle. But you know what? We've also seen God moving all around the world. If we open our eyes, we'll always see God in the headlines. Let's take a look at what Sydney found today.
A runner who was carried to the finish line says her faith played a part. Haley Klinger is a junior at Messiah College in Pennsylvania. She was 100 yards away from completing a half marathon in Philadelphia when her legs gave out. Klinger says she started to feel weak and lightheaded at the 11-mile mark. But just as she went down, two men came to her side to help her finish the race. Brian Krinkovic and Joseph McGinty helped her cross the finish line. Klinger says months before the race, she asked God to make her bold and courageous in her faith. She says she believes God used the event as a way to share her faith. The situation, Klinger said, taught her this. I learned that when we are pushed outside of our comfort zone and face challenges or difficulties, God will carry us through. And in this case, these men were placed in my life when I needed help.
Wow, praise God. Isn't it good to know that we always have God there ready to step in and to give us what it is that we need?
Yeah, and friends to help us and carry us over the finish line. You know, sometimes we need a friend, and thank God that Jesus is a friend that sticks closer to than a brother, but we also have, like, friends down here on earth that help us, and we ought to be that kind of friend that helps somebody make it, helps somebody finish over cross over the finish line, so to speak.
Amen.
In life.
Well, you know what? We've got a great person to join us. Why don't you bring Sydney out right now and come on out and chit-chat with us for a moment.
Hello.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
What did you think about what we just saw there on the TV?
Well, you know, it's interesting, actually, but before, like, we went on air, the one thing I heard God speaking to me is that Ecclesiastes 9, where it says the race is not given to the swift, and time and chance happens to them all. And I think in the race of life, right, sometimes it's like you're running, it's like a marathon, you're pushing hard, and she, like, right before she crossed the finish line, she felt like she was going to give up. But I feel like a lot of times in our lives, mm-hmm. when we're going through adversity, when we're going through trouble, when we're going through a tribulation, it's like your legs give out. You go weak, and you're like, I don't know if I can push through. But those two men, I really believe, is like a sign showing that we have people that are beside us, our Christian yeah. brothers and sisters, to help us push through the finish line. So right. it's like we can't do this alone. We need one another to help us cross the finish line.
Right.
And that's the reason why we all need to make sure we reach out to one another. We can reach out to the prayer partners. Mm-hmm. We can reach out to one another. Mm-hmm. Even us as pastors, we need one another at times.
Oh, yeah. I mean, many times everybody goes through something. And
that's right.
everybody is going to go, whether it's today, tomorrow, next week, you're going to go through something. And when you do, have you built friendships and relationships
right.
that are going to be there with you in life that you can talk to? We're not supposed to live life isolated and all alone and to ourselves. God puts the lonely or the solitary in a family. Mm-hmm. I mean, we need each other.
Yeah.
And you know what? We need to be cheering each other on.
Right.
You know,
that's
like,
right.
you're going to make it as
right.
you're engaged and you're heading into this new marriage. You're going to make it,
that's
Jay,
right. that's
on
right.
the hill with your church. Like, we need to cheer each other on and
Amen.
Be there for each other and not be just focused on ourselves.
Right.
You know, we were just talking, Sydney, in the back about you're getting ready to get married here in just
yeah.
a couple of months.
Yeah.
And the importance of even having mentorships,
mm-hmm.
Even in relationships.
Yeah.
I know for me, I'm only 5 years in, and I still appreciate the mentors I have in our life. So that was just some things that we had mentioned in the back there.
Yeah, I think accountability is, like, so important to have that
yeah.
mentorship. Important because, like, my fiance and I, we've never been married. We need all that, you know, the help and all the ministry that we can get to help us, you know, run that race of marriage together. So it's really important, you know, and I one thing I love about here so much is that being around so many people that are married and have strong marriages, that they're constantly pouring in and giving me advice, you know, about marriage. It's a really beautiful, beautiful thing.
Yeah, well, I'm excited for you.
Thank you.
Marriage
is
a blast. Now,
it is
hard work, let me tell you, but
Amen.
It is a blast to being married, you know, to have somebody in your corner with you.
How many years have you been married?
21.
21 years. And what was difficult? Did you have people in your life that you had that were mentors, that people kind of pulled you along the way to help you in your relationship?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Even still today, we have people, you know, we look for people that we want to be like them.
Amen.
And they've gone ahead and they've done it well. And so we do have several people. And every time we're with them, we're saying, here's what's going on in our life. Take a look in. Tell us how we can tweak it. Tell us what we need to do to make it better. Because you always need to be learning and growing. You only know what you know. You need that insight and that help, that iron sharpens iron, from other people.
And we should always look to friend up in our lives.
Yeah.
Not just have, don't always seek for advice from those that are just on your same level.
Right.
Always friend up. Have people in ministry, we
right.
need it.
Yep.
In our marriages, we need
right.
it. Financially, if you're broke, go to somebody that's got money and ask them, how do you got what it is that you have?
Right.
We all need some help.
Right, right. And I just wonder, you know, maybe today you feel all alone And I want you to know how much we are cheering you on. Amen. I mean, when we're out and about in the week and in the months, we talk to you and we hear from you. And we want you to know that we've got your back. We're praying for you. Amen. We believe in you. We know God has an incredible plan for your life. Man, you're going to make it through that marriage thing. You're going to make it in that financial thing. You're going to make it through that sickness. God loves you and cares for you, and so do we. Well, amen. Still to come, Tim Burgan tells us what's new with nightlife, and Katie Farrell brings us a healthy alternative for breadsticks. Yes, we'll be right back.
When I lost my job, our bills kept coming faster than we could pay them. My wife and I feel like we were drowning, that there was no way to be free.
My addiction became worse and worse until one day my wife found me on the floor. I need hope.
I wish I could feel joy again. I've become so negative.
Every day our prayer partners take calls from hurting people. We're working in God's harvest field 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Will you join us in this kingdom work? When you become a harvest partner, we're going to send you our Turning the Tide teaching on DVD, 2 CD set, and a study guide. This is a powerful teaching to help turn the tide in your life. We'll send it along with our beautiful harvest partner mug. This is our gift to you. Call now.
We're so thankful for our harvest partners. If you would consider joining in and locking arms with us, like we were talking about relationships, and we can do more when we hook up together. So simple, $25 a month helps us bring good news television and the good news that Jesus loves people 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Amen.
So good.
Amen. So join with us. And right now, I'm so excited. I got a little bit of a surprise last night when I got the email for the show, because Nightlife is here, and it's a cornerstone weekend late night show. Tim Burgan is the host, and he's joined with, guess who? My twin brothers, Kirk and Kellen, to talk about what's new with Nightlife. Nightlife, welcome to Real Life.
Hey.
Glad to be here.
Yes,
glad to be here.
And
we just, you know, we need to let you know, let our partners know that part of their giving, like you were saying, Amy, part of their giving makes our show happen.
Right.
And we've got this unique program. I mean, in order to give you the real feel, guys, do you think you can do just a little bit? Sydney, we need you out here. You got to have the whole team. Whole team out here. I mean, Robin's not here this morning. We should drag John up here. But you guys ready?
Can you give us a beat, Tim?
A beat. Okay, yeah.
This is
what I do on a show.
Okay.
It's time once again, and we're here for your enjoyment. Living it up, laughing it up, while we're lifting them up on Nightlife. Living it up, laughing it up, while we're lifting them up on Nightlife. Nightlife, Nightlife, Nightlife.
Yeah.
So I taught them everything they know.
Jay, what do you feel about this?
Man, you know what? They're a blast. We were on there, remember?
Yeah,
we were on
there.
We counted on there for the, I think it was like
the marriage.
Marriage,
thing.
Yeah. You guys, yeah. Yep. We still have worries about that. We pray for you guys often. So, no.
That was a blast. So tell us a little bit about Nightlife. What can people expect when they watch the show?
The show is somewhat totally different for Christian television as a whole. It is not different for Cornerstone Television, because Cornerstone Television has always been an innovator when it comes to quality Christian programming, yeah. Programming to reach different segments of people. And so we've got, these guys are, I mean, they are the most talented. I don't know what it was like growing up with them, but they are the most talented musicians, I know.
That's cool.
And you got Sydney. Sydney's got a heart of gold. She's sharing these stories that tie everything in, and it's great. But we have some of the greatest guests. You guys were on. You talked about your marriages.
Yeah.
But recently, we had a guest on that he took time out of his busy day from Trump Tower 2 in Washington, D.C. And we'd like to just show you a little clip of this guest.
Awesome.
I
I am really liking this television program. It's called Nightlife. One word, capital N, capital L. Smash them together, Nightlife. Nightlife, very catchy, simple, excellent branding. Excellent. Believe me, I know a little something about one word branding, big league. It's on Friday and Saturday at midnight. And let me tell you right now, it is tremendous, unbelievable. Much better than that overrated Saturday night show on the failing Peacock Network. Don't even get me started.
See, we figured.
That's kind of a big deal.
Well, we're here to make a big announcement that the show time change is happening, but who better to do it than to have our president make the announcement?
Right, right.
So, no, that's Tom Cox. He's a great guy. He's an impersonator. And that's the key thing that we want to talk about is that the show is shifting from 10:30 on Friday and Saturday nights to midnight. Mm-hmm. And because after all, the show, who we're going after are the people that that are up that late at night, that you know, they're looking for something. This show, it will always encourage Christians. Everything Cornerstone Television does is there to encourage Christians and to build them up. But we're trying to go beyond reaching Christians to reaching people that are maybe like you know, some of your CEO Christians, people who are Christian, Christmas and Easter only Christians that are out there, and other people that are like, you know what, I'm not sure about this God thing, but you know, with this talent. With the talent here, these guys just sharing, people see their hearts, they see their love. We get the opportunity to talk with great people like you guys and others, and we do it in a slightly different way that's fun. I mean, have you guys eaten anything more awful than things that you've eaten on this program? Now, it's not a cooking show, but we've eaten
what
some pretty awful
eaten?
Stuff.
The jelly bean, yes, we play Bean Boozled. That is, I've eaten some rotten fish. I've eaten rotten eggs.
No.
Spoiled milk. But
Sydney.
She always wins.
Jesus, he covers me.
So, I think it's fixed. Yeah. I think it's fixed. There's got to be something going on with that. So,
with the only lady on the crew, you know, you got to give a little props to her.
Yeah. That's right. Yes, yes.
So take me inside a nightlife show. It's going to be fun, entertaining, meaty. I mean, so you're eating, you're doing music. Well, give me some insight.
It really is a mix of things, Amy. What we do is inside the show, we have the guys do some great and creative music. They will often have a special song. Sydney will do. Tell them what you do.
So I have, it's called like the Night Scoop. So I do like inspirational stories that are tie in with the theme of the show to show like how God is moving too.
Yeah, nice.
Yeah, so it goes along that line. And we always have an open and close to the show that are tied in a way that we can let people know what the heart of the show is going to be. We always have a theme. There's always some kind of theme. Mm-hmm. With Tom being on the show, the guy that just played Donald Trump, we talk about empathy, for example. And in that show, it is people. No, don't go there. Don't go there. Don't let your mind go there. The point is that this country is divided.
Yeah.
We are divided politically. Mm-hmm. We are divided racially. We are divided economically. Mm-hmm. We are divided by age groups. There are so many divisions in this nation, and we have them in our churches. You know, I think it's healthy to have churches of different economic strata, different races, different age groups. I think that's healthy, different even politically. Mm-hmm. How do you get along with someone? How do you empathize? Can you love someone who has a different political position than you have? Mm-hmm. Can you love someone who thinks totally differently than you do? And that's part of what we do. And we do that in a fun way.
Yeah.
We do that in a way that hopefully is entertaining. We do that in a way that, and then with these guys adding, you know, their life to the show, with the interviews, with the segments, with everything, every little segment, there's nothing that would allow you to get bored. There's too many things going on.
Well, I'm going to throw a little question to my brothers here, because it would, I think, be apropos for me to mention something to them. What do you guys like best about nightlife, and what is it that you bring to the show?
I think I enjoy just the part, like Tim was saying, you have different people, even people on the set and the team were from different denominations, were different races, different ages, and we all come together.
We're different races.
I mean,
that's our brother from another mother over there.
That's what I say.
I was going to talk about the fro you had in the 70s, Tim, but I'm not going to go there. When you had the red fro, it would have made a little bit more. But it's been such a great time, and I think that's what we love about Tim. Tim is really on the set. He's really the, besides the producer and stuff, he's really our, the general. Yeah, he's the one that puts everything together. Sid is the one that comes with the great stories and the humor. Kirk and I are the ones that also bring music and humor, and it's just everybody comes together unified. And, you know, the Bible says that as we come together, there's nothing that God can't do. You know, he'll bring life and favor as we're unified, and that's what he's doing.
And I think what I like about it is that we try to be salt and light in a different way. Mm-hmm. You know, like Tim said, that people are watching it late at night, the new time, midnight. So when people are watching it on midnight, that they'll see, and someone might be coming home, maybe from a bar, maybe from a rough situation going on, that they can turn on and say, wow, I wasn't expecting that. But at the same time, be ministered to and leave and say, wow. You know what? That really touched my life. Mm-hmm. And that's really what our goal is as a team on Nightlife, is that.
Amen.
Have you heard any stories or has anybody responded from watching the shows like, oh, thanks for going there, like, or I was helped, or?
Actually, it was funny. We were, Kel and I were in a Planet Fitness one time, and one of the gentlemen was like, hey, he's like, you guys are the twins. I saw you guys on television. And he was like, wow. He's like, you know, keep ministering the gospel. You know, basically just saying how he just walked by, just giving us like a pat on the back, saying it's so great to see you guys ministering. You know, it's so great to see young people taking time to minister the gospel. So that was great.
The only thing, though, is they were like, Denzel, The Rock. I was like, no, that's not me. I'm just coming. I'm Kirk. And I was like, you know, I know I get that all the time, but you know, I'm just Kirk and Kellen, and that's just what we do. So.
We have a lot of forgiveness in this show, too.
That's funny.
That's
good.
Mainly what we want to do, we don't want you to get lost in the sauce here. We need you to know that it's shifting to midnight, Friday and Saturdays, and that you want to tell your friends and your family and outside people you work with, this is a show they can watch, and they're going to get something out of it, and then you can talk to them Monday morning.
All right, can you sing us out?
Living it up, laughing it up, while we're lifting them up on Nightlife, 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 Nightlife.
Wow. Thank you guys for coming. Obviously, Nightlife has a new time at midnight, and Will Smith and I here.
Yeah. I'll ask, who are they?
You know, who are you?
Got Holly Berry and
Sean Connery.
Sean Connery.
Thanks. The old guy.
So, moving on, it's kind of hard when you're with these guys, which is awesome. Man. On today's Dashing Dish, our friend Katie Farrell has another great recipe for us, cauliflower breadsticks. Let's see what she's cooking in the kitchen.
Hi, I'm Katie with Dashing Dish. Today I'm going to show you how to make breadsticks using cauliflower. And I love using cauliflower in so many of my recipes. It's a great way to replace so many breads, and you can actually use it as a rice substitute in a lot of recipes. So in order to make the cauliflower for this recipe in particular, you just have to do something called rice it. And so you can do that if you have a really high power blender or food processor. I have a little mini food processor here just to show you kind of how it's done. So you just take the whole head of cauliflower and you would put it in a food processor or in a blender. And then you just kind of pulse it until it reaches the stage of a rice. And that's why it's called ricing. So you can see I have a whole cauliflower head riced here in the bowl. And to that, you're just going to add some cheese and some egg whites and seasoning. And it's really that simple. So here I have some Parmesan cheese, and I'm gonna add a half cup. And I love using Parmesan cheese because it gives a lot of flavor for a cheese with a little amount of calories. So as opposed to, say, a grated cheese, Parmesan cheese packs a lot of flavor. So I love using it in my recipes, and instead of using it as breadcrumbs, using breadcrumbs in, say, a meatloaf, I use Parmesan cheese a lot of times because it acts as a really good binder. And then the other cheese we have here is some mozzarella. And I'm going to do a half cup of that. And then I'm going to add the seasonings. I have garlic powder here, and I love garlic powder because, really, you need garlic in any kind of breadstick, in my opinion. And then Italian seasoning. And I'm just adding 1 teaspoon of both. And then I'm going to add just a pinch of salt and pepper, just to flavor the cauliflower a little bit. And then I'm gonna mix this together a little. And when you mix this up, it kind of combines all of the flavors of the seasonings and the cheeses. And you know, I personally don't like to cut out any food groups out of my diet. I like to eat everything in moderation, but if you are trying to limit your carbohydrates, cauliflower breadsticks are a great swap out. So here I have two egg whites, and I'm gonna add this, and this just binds everything together. And the great thing about these breadsticks is it really takes just a few ingredients. They're ready in about 15 to 20 minutes. So if you're making them for a crowd or say game day, they're ready really quickly. And then they're about 50 calories per breadstick. So even if you ate the entire tray, you're eating about 500 calories, which it may just happen with this recipe because they're that good. So make sure you have someone around to share it with. And then as you can see, I lined my baking pan here with parchment paper. And I love using parchment paper or foil on my pan when I'm making something because you can just take it right off and throw it away. And that way you don't even have to wash your pans when you're done. And I'm all about keeping it simple in the kitchen. I don't like making a huge mess. I don't like dirtying a lot of dishes. So that's a really simple way of doing so. So once you mix this all together and it's nice and combined, you want to make sure those egg whites really get in there to kind of bind everything. You can put everything onto the parchment paper here. And then you form it into a rectangle or whatever shape you'd like. And it looks like it's not really going to hold together, but once you bake it and the cheese and the egg bind everything together, you will see that you will have the perfect breadsticks for dipping. So I'm going to do kind of a rectangle shape here. And you know, you could even do like a football shape. You can get creative and do whatever you'd like. And then what you'll want to do is preheat your oven, bake this at 425 degrees for about 15 minutes, and then take it out of the oven. And for the last 5 minutes, you'll want to sprinkle it with some more mozzarella cheese. So I have some here. So if we had already baked this about 15 minutes, we would just add the cheese, and then we would bake it for another, say 5 to 10 minutes until the cheese is melted. And then you can see here we have the finished product. And you can make them really as thin or thick as you'd like. The thicker that they are, it's gonna be a little easier for dipping, but you can dip it in some marinara sauce. And there you go. You have the cauliflower breadsticks that everyone will love. And so if you would like to find this recipe, you can get it at ctvn.org. And I hope you guys have a wonderful rest of your day and enjoy.
Wow. All right. Cauliflower breadsticks. Change your life, huh?
I mean, I do want to try it because I really like bread.
Yeah. Yeah. Everybody's always trying to get, how do we get the bread in there without the calories?
Right. So I'm gonna try that, actually. How did Easter dinner and lunch go, or whatever you guys did?
Well, we went to a restaurant. I'm not going to say where, but went to a restaurant. We didn't have a really good experience.
Oh, no.
So it was one of those, but we had like 10 people. We ended up getting our whole meal for free. So I guess it was a blessing, and I don't want to say a curse, but it didn't turn out great, but it was good. It was great to be with our family and just have a good time together, but we didn't eat healthy. So we need shows like this because we got to get back on track.
We need more cauliflower breadsticks in our life. We actually kind of did something special for our Easter dinner. Did not cook at all because after a full weekend of five service, it just could not cook. So we went to the Doubletree, which is where we had our very first service on Easter Sunday 20 years ago. It was actually called the Radisson and then the Doubletree. So we ate in the same room that we had our first church service in 20 years ago. It was very like, I could care less what we even ate. Just being there on that day and just reminiscing about the goodness and the faithfulness of God, starting with 30 people, and then where you're at 20 years later, and just the staying power and the goodness of God. It was a sweet lunch.
That's awesome. I mean, it kind of reminds me of that statement back. They used to sing a song back then. When I look back over my life,
yeah.
and see all that is done for me. My soul cries out.
That's right.
You know, I mean, you guys have been, so you and Buck were only married 1 year then.
We were married 1 year.
Wow, and you started
imagine?
A church.
Like, oh, let's go start a church. This was before church planning was popular, before they had organizations. I mean, we came cold turkey. I don't even know how people knew we were starting, maybe flyers from Kinko's, and just started with what we had and just stayed put in the hard times. That's kind of the secret, is to stay put in the hard times.
That stick-to-itiveness, no matter how difficult it gets, no matter how hard it is, keep going. I like, we come off of Easter, but the Bible says, who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despised the shame. Mm-hmm. It's just so awesome to be able to know you guys and know that you've made it 20 years in ministry. Yeah. That's awesome. Praise
God
for that.
How long have you been pastoring now?
Well, I've been in ministry since 96, but this church that I'm at right now, I got installed in 2015 of November.
Wow.
So we're only a year and a couple months in.
Wow. You're a baby.
So we're new to the game here in Pittsburgh. It's good to be here, though.
Man, we still have a great program coming up. But right now, it is Good News with Sydney Grant.
I'm Sydney Grant for Good News 360. Here's how the Holy Spirit is moving around the world. Muslim converts are breathing new life into Europe's struggling churches. Fox News reports a soaring number of refugees from Syria, Iraq, and Afghanistan are leaving Islam and receiving salvation. We're told they're flocking to various Christian denominations. For decades, European churches have struggled to share the gospel. Church leaders say former Muslims seem to be much more open to the message of Jesus Christ. The church in Hungary is calling on leaders to speak up for refugees. Catholic and Protestant Christians are backing an online petition urging pastors to respond to the refugee crisis. They're asking for church leaders to ensure the government puts in place humane treatment and basic assistance in border areas. Christians say they want church leaders to be a reflection of the love of Christ. Christians in Morocco took a major step for defending their rights. For the first time ever, believers brought the request to the National Council of Human Rights. Requests included basic rights like freedom of worship and making Christian churches official. They also asked if they could celebrate Christian marriages and name their children biblical names. In Morocco, the law only considers Islam and Judaism as religious options for citizens. Well, that's all for Good News 360. Have a great day on purpose.
Well, Sydney always does such a wonderful job with the good news. And I love the stories there because it's showing Christians rising up. And if there's ever been a time that we need to stand up and make our voice heard, it's now.
Oh, that's right. And it gives us, too, a visual and a picture of the global church. Because we just see what we know in our own cities, in our own area, and the believers that we know here. But there's a whole bunch of Christians and believers. Muslims turning to Christians that are helping breathe life into the church. Amen. I mean, that's amazing. I mean, God really is moving all over. It's not just here. We see God moving here, but he is moving in what we think are the really hard places.
That's right. That's right. You know, and I believe, too, we need to rise up more now than ever because we have a president in office that really wants to stand up for Christian rights and for a Christian movement. Mm-hmm. If there's ever been a time that the church needs to fast, to pray, to petition our White House, whatever it might be, it's now because I believe we are positioned for God to do a major reformation in our country.
Right. I saw a video that the president put out, one of his weekly videos about honoring the Jewish Passover and honoring the Christian Easter celebration. And I just thought, wow, like I had not heard that in a long time coming from one of the number one top world leaders.
Wow.
And so,
awesome.
I mean, really it's helping us give that little fresh breath behind Christian values,
Amen.
The Judeo-Christian values that we need to help us kind of win beneath our wings, so to speak.
Amen, amen. So I think it's so important. Let's pray. Let's believe God. Pastors, let's rise up and let's see a wonderful, wonderful thing take place in our nation. What's coming up, Amy?
All right, so the moms are here talking all about beauty. What do you think about it? How do you feel about it? Let's go to the moms and hear from them.
Welcome to Mom Talk. We are so glad to be back with you. It feels like it's been forever since we've seen you. If we haven't met, I'm Anna, and joining me today, I have Carly and Christine. So yes, we're talking about the topic of beauty today, which is something We as women, we ache over this issue. I was looking up some statistics and I found that in a 2013 study, it showed that we spent $426 billion on beauty products, $60 billion on diet and exercise, $12 billion on fashion, and $12 billion on plastic and cosmetic surgery. 92% of all those procedures were gotten by women.
Of course.
Yes. So, from the time that we're this big until even today, and I think maybe until the day we leave this earth, we will ache over this issue of beauty. Christine, what's your take on this?
Well, I have to admit, if I'm being completely honest, that I'm struggling with it a little bit right now because I'm hitting that point where everything's a little saggy. Everything's not exactly where it used to be. And I'm an actor. So I went to college for acting. I went to graduate school for acting. And I know that as an actor, when I step out onto an audition, you are judged within the first 4 seconds we're taught. Before you speak, before you do your audition piece, you are judged by the way that you look. So I've lived with that like my whole life, like with my training, and I know that. And so it's hard for me to watch myself age and to see myself and but I have to, and now I have a daughter who has a facial difference.
Okay.
And so she's very aware of it. We took Easter pictures a while back and you know, I said, sweetheart, let's go. We're going to go take pictures. And she said, but I have a crooked lip.
Aww.
I'm like, oh, baby.
She's 10, right?
She's nine. Almost 10.
Yeah.
And so I have to continue to go and watch as God changes my spirit, you know, to be more like him, because the beauty has to come from inside.
That's right.
It can't come from this, because it will fade, ladies. If it hasn't faded yet, it starts.
So how do you speak to your daughter? Have you found that the way you speak to her, you also have to give yourself that pep talk?
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, sweetheart, you are beautiful. You're just the way God made you.
Yes.
You know, God made you this way, and you are beautiful.
Right.
And don't let anybody tell you any differently.
Yeah.
You know, she
you
is.
To constantly redirect them. It's like, it's something I think we're going to do even as they grow into women, mm-hmm. as their mother. Like, for my daughter, too, she's, you know, 18 and still struggling with all that stuff. And I think of that scripture where it says to cultivate, I think in 1 Peter 3, cultivate that inner beauty, that gentle, quiet spirit within. That's like a calmness.
Yeah, right.
And then also in Psalms where it says, like a warrior, children are arrows. So it's like a redirect their thoughts, because like they're going to complain about what they look like. They're going to say issues that may be accurate sometimes for their own mind.
Right.
And, you know, and then the emotions are so high.
Mm-hmm.
And so you must just got to let them blood out.
Yeah. To validate how they're feeling.
Yes. And understand it. But our job is to re-aim them to truth, to the word, to that inner beauty, and that cultivate, that's a work, that's a job, that's something that you do.
Right.
And that word cultivate actually means to work the soil and to encourage. So it's that
that's
constant
good.
Redirect, and even for us, redirect, arrow them to truth, which is inner beauty. And it does, and I think the most beautiful thing is worshiping God. You just feel lighter, you feel calmer, you feel better when you're worshiping him. And when we do that in front of our children and together, it does create beauty.
Right. Now, how have you seen social media impact your daughter as a teenager growing up with that and her beauty?
I literally want to just take her phone and break it sometimes.
Yes.
Like, because again, where's your focus?
Mm-hmm.
If your focus is constantly on perfection, we have to look at ourselves in the mirror how many times a day?
Yeah.
You know, but are we looking in the mirror of the Word of God?
Mm-hmm.
And that's the true reflection.
I think we talk about the beautiful people. Oh, look at the beautiful people. You know, there were the beautiful people in your high school, they're the beautiful people that are on television, they're the beautiful people. But we see this, you know, the Bible says, you see on the outside, I see on the inside.
Yes,
when we say we see the beautiful people, we're talking about like the outside. And you can be perfect and you can have all kinds of cosmetic surgery to make you look even more perfect than you already are.
Yeah.
But does it change your heart? Yeah. Who are you on the inside?
Right.
And I mean, that's really the crux of a human being.
Yeah.
You can be beautiful on the outside and you can just be truly ugly inside.
That's so true. I've been doing a lot of study about a woman's heart and how we uniquely bear God's image. And one of the ways that we uniquely bear God's image is his beauty.
Right.
So God is beauty. Therefore, we can confidently say that every woman, every girl has a beauty to unveil.
That's right.
And that's what it is. It's an unveiling of that beauty. Yes, we might be beautiful on the outside, but there is an even deeper beauty that has to be cultivated, that has to be put in the light. And I actually grabbed this morning on my way out. This is some crystal necklaces that my great-grandma gave to me. And they are naturally beautiful. Right. But if you put these crystals in the light, it unveils an even deeper beauty inside of them. And it really is just such a picture of, as we learn who we are in Christ, the way that God made us, who he says we are, that is the definition, that the truth
Absolutely.
That we have to maintain. And I have found, even with my own struggles with beauty, you know, having eating disorders as a teenager, getting older and seeing more wrinkles. I have an autoimmune disease, vitiligo, that's stripping away pigment from my skin just little by little. And, you know, this really does, we can focus on that, or we can focus on that inner beauty and have it just keep drawing it out. That's and true. We were even saying that a confident woman is a beautiful
Absolutely.
Woman.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I asked my husband, I said, well, do you have any thoughts? Because he always gives me a thought before we'll come on for a certain, and he said, confidence in a woman, it shows me, you know, that she's beautiful in herself because she has confidence in who she is and what she's doing.
Right.
Yep. Yeah. And I think, too, just a final word that I wanted to throw in was, I think as moms, we have to be careful how we're talking about our outer beauty in front of our daughters, because they pick up on that. And
how you talk to them. So, like, be careful. Like, it's good to have honesty with them. Like, you don't be, like, but to also be careful that you're like, what are you wearing? Because instantly it showed what's wrong with me. That's instant insecurity. So, by our
be
words.
So gentle and careful in how we talk to our daughters
and
about
calm.
That. Yes. All right. Well, thanks, ladies. It's always nice to have you here. And man, I love this topic. We could talk about it all day.
All day.
Yes. All right. Well, we are also so glad that you were with us today. We want you to know that you do have a beauty to unveil because you were made in God's image. Thank you so much for being with us. And we are going to transition into a health segment talking about inner beauty and outer beauty. Doctors Mark and Michelle are committed to helping the body of Christ have a healthy body. So here they are to talk about decreasing excess fat. Take a look.
Hi, everyone. Hi, sweetheart. Listen, I'm reading a menu and I'm staying focused. I'm trying to exercise self-control when it comes to making these healthy choices. There's so many of them. I can't look to the right or I can't look to the left. Listen, we need wisdom and self-control. We all know that. I know it looked pretty silly, but listen, they work. People think good choices like exercise can eliminate bad choices, like what we eat. That is not true, is it, Dr. Michelle?
You could work out 2 hours a day and never lose weight if you're making poor decisions, poor nutritional decisions the rest of the day. The most important medical decision you make every day is what's at the end of your fork. We need two gifts that God promises every believer can access. And that's wisdom and self-control.
So, we're gonna get practical in the next couple minutes here with some wise eating choices. Breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And I'm gonna teach you as well how to put on your blinders too. You may have more time than you think. Prepare to make the time, even if getting up earlier is what you need to do, or while watching Cornerstone TV in the kitchen. These are some good healthy choices right here. Of course, we have avocados, we have nuts, we have eggs, we have some pears, some apples, some grapes, some kale, some berries. I have my blinders focused right here. That's all I can see. These things are important because when we begin to put these in our system each day, we find our body functioning better and much easier time avoiding those bad food temptations. So, put these things in and watch carbohydrate consumption after 6 p.m.
Food temptations are real. Self-control is not impossible for a believer. It's a fruit of the Spirit.
You know, the Bible talks about the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians chapter 5. And it's clear that self-control is not something you should actually try to generate on your own. Instead, it should come very, very natural to you as a fruit. Just like this fruit comes from a tree. When the seed is planted in the ground, the tree comes up and fruit is natural. So don't try to generate self-control. Sometimes just trust simply in God. He puts this stuff in our lives for us to eat. Now, I told you I'd teach you how to put on the blinders. All it takes is duct tape and two pieces of cardboard, and it works. So real life family, I want to challenge you to put your spiritual blinders on. Whether it be duct tape and cardboard, it doesn't matter. We don't have to fall victim to those horrible temptations. And I tell you, you can even go one step further, real life family, and you can get a picture of maybe Don over here and Terry over here. And then your choices will be clear. It'll be about God, what God wants for you, and to stay away what the devil wants for you as well.
Hi, I'm Denise Graves, and I'd just like to say over the years I've had such the privilege and honor of doing music and ministry together and behind the scenes, in front of the camera, bringing you more than a song this show. And I just want to thank you for your support, for watching Christian television, watching Cornerstone Television. And they bring you great talent, great entertainment, but most importantly, great ministry. So thank you for watching, but most importantly, thank you for sponsoring and continuing to sponsor this great cause. So thank you, thank you, thank you.
How excellent is thy name, O Lord. How excellent is thy name. Heaven and earth together proclaim. How excellent is thy name.
Well, praise God. I love this part of the show because it's an opportunity where we get a chance to pray for you and stand in the gap for you. And if you haven't gotten your prayer request in, get it in now, 888-665-4483. We want to pray with you and believe God for a supernatural breakthrough in your life. And we've got a great scripture that we want to break down for you for just a moment. If you've got a Bible, go to Exodus chapter 6, verses 6 and 7, but it should come up on the television there. Therefore, say to the children of Israel, I am the Lord. I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. I will rescue you from their bondage, and I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with great judgments. I will take you as my people, and I will be your God. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God, who brings you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. Hallelujah. One of God's promises is to set free every captive. Are you in bondage to people, drugs, alcohol, or anything at all that may be holding you back? Today is your time. Right now is your moment. Jesus is passing by. Reach out to God and let him rescue you and redeem you for not just now or what you're currently in, but for the rest of your life. Do you realize today that he created you for a special purpose? Reach out to him. He's passing by because he wants to bring freedom and a new life to you. You know, I'm so excited. I believe today that God wants to set
some people free from whatever bondage that they're in today. Mm-hmm.
This is called the Four Cups of Redemption. I will bring you out. I will rescue you. I will redeem you. Amen. And then you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to take you as my own.
Hallelujah.
I mean, think about that. This is what the gospel is all about. He redeems us. He redeems our life from the pit. He rescues us from destruction. Mm-hmm. And then he not only does that, but then he takes us and he sets our feet up on a rock. Man, and he gives us glory and honor and dignity and worth. And he's just a good Father.
Yes, he is. And what a great message to focus on this week coming out of Easter. There is this empty grave that Jesus has conquered. Sin has conquered bondage, has conquered death. And whatever you are facing today, because Jesus is risen, we have this living hope that we don't have to stay where we are. Things are not as they appear here. There is supernatural happenings all around us.
Have you guys ever been in a situation where you feel, maybe early on in your walk with Christ, where you felt like, you know what, nobody knows I'm here. Nobody knows what I'm going through. Nobody understands, you know, what a walkthrough. You were talking about vitiligo and the issues and sometimes things like that. And I think a lot of times people feel that way when they call in, they write and they say, you know what, I need healing, I need this. Mm-hmm. But the thing is that God sees you. That's what I can't imagine the miracle of Jesus looking down, being on the cross and looking down through time and space and seeing every one of our sins, every one of our burdens and saying, you know what, I see you.
Yeah.
I see you. He sees you right there. Mm-hmm. And I think it's important for all of us. We've walked through it, right? Aim, you've been there.
Yeah.
You guys have been there. You know, we've been in that situation. And the cool thing, one of the cool things about the word intercession, that word broken down in the Greek really means the Holy Spirit comes and he sees us where we are. Mm-hmm. He empathizes with our pain, with our suffering, with what we're going through, but he doesn't leave us there. He lifts us out.
Mm-hmm.
And that is so cool. That's happened for each one of us, and it can happen for you too. And and that's, as we're praying, I just want to say that, because as we're praying, I want you to know God knows you. He knows what you're going through. Mm-hmm. This isn't something where he's sitting up there saying, what in the world is Daniel asking for prayer for, or Diane asking for prayer for? He knows, he sees you. And that's so cool about God, who he is.
I love that you bring that up, because just last week I was talking with some women who felt like, does God really see them? Mm-hmm. There's so many people in this world. How can he really truly care about that one individual? But truly he does. And he has seen that person since before the earth was even here.
You know, Amy, I think many times too, people are satisfied with God having their sins forgiven, but he wants to do so much more.
That's right.
He doesn't want to just give you life away from hell. He wants to give you the abundant life. And I believe God wants to set them free from everything. He wants them to be free, not just from hell, but from everything in their lives.
Cool. Right.
Very cool, Jay.
Brother Hagin, one of the fathers of in my faith, he said, people come to the cross and they stop there.
That's right.
And we're thankful for the cross where he actually took our place. Like, we deserve the punishment. But he said, you know what? I'm going to take the punishment upon myself. So he took our place. But then we move past the cross into that abundant life that he has for us. And I think that's where the key is. Very you have to know that he loves you passionately.
Amen.
And you know what? He's not okay with abuse.
That's right.
He's not okay with the addictions that are holding you back. He wants you free.
That's right.
He wants to help you. He wants to bring you out, to redeem you from that and to rescue that from that tough relationship or that sickness or disease that has tried to attach itself to you. By his stripes, you are healed. Past tense, you are healed. So we believe it today that the abundant life will come into your life and family and home.
Well, I want to look at some prayer requests here. Mm-hmm. Shannon called in and said she wants to be closer to the Lord, but wants to keep living with her boyfriend. She's finding it so hard to stand for truth. This scripture is for you today, Shannon. God wants to deliver you, and he wants to set you free from whatever it is that's holding you back. And then Joy called in because a friend of hers named Patty had a stroke, and she's back in the hospital, and she's praying for healing and deliverance of her body. And I also want to send a shout out. There's a pastor friend of mine whose family member recently had a stroke, and they're in the ICU, and we're believing God for a breakthrough in your life.
And I have Shannon here. She has a new baby. She's very tired and she needs strength and she needs help. And I just babysat my little niece last week for a week. 1 year old, and I forgot what it was to be that tired.
Do you remember? Do you remember those days?
I'm like right there, right now with you, sister. We're praying for strength. And then another lady, she's pregnant, she's working full time, and she has two small children. Listen, God will give you strength. Just ask Him. He's as close as the mention of His name. Mm-hmm.
Yes, and following up on the mama prayer request there, we have Leah, who is recovering. She just gave birth, and so she is also very exhausted and healing. She also is asking for prayer for her husband and favor as they are buying a house. We also have Susie, who called in with some different physical needs. She's also seeking wisdom, and she really needs to hear from God. Diane asking for healing, having some hormone issues, and looking for that healing on her body. And, you know, Amy, you were saying about how God is such a good father, and that we move beyond the cross and know that God doesn't want to leave us broken, like a child in ICU. He's not going to be okay to leave them there. He wants to come in and completely heal. Completely heal. Yes.
And along with healing, I've got some healing requests here as well, but got a couple that are asking for people in their families to come to know Jesus. And it goes back to that I was mentioning earlier about God sees them. Right. As much as each one of these folks are wanting the healing, as much as the woman is hurting because she's so tired because of the baby and things like that, God sees it all. Yeah. And He's saying, you know what, I love you and I love these folks more than you know.
Right. So.
Yeah. And just real quickly, as we get ready to pray here, Melinda called in and she's 91 years old and wanted to know what it meant to be born again.
Amen.
And so we thank God for you. And all you have to do to be born again is just ask Jesus into your heart, receive His death, burial, and resurrection for all your sins, and you'll be for sure as heaven as if you're already there. I like to say it like this: God will do for you what a phone booth did for Clark Kent. Turn you into another man or turn you into a brand another woman. Awesome. So let's just put these in the middle here, and can we just pray a prayer? Pastor Tim, would you just pray? And
Father, you are the one that still moves stones. And Lord, the stones on people's hearts, the stones in people's lives that are hindering them.
Yes.
Father, we just celebrated how you moved the stone and Jesus was alive. Father, move on these people's lives.
Yes.
Touch their
yes.
hearts. Touch their lives. Move on their behalf. Father, Jesus' body was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities, and by His stripes, we indeed, as Amy said, are healed. We are presently healed. Thank you for that. Thank you for this one who came to know you. And Father, I thank you for even more that are coming. Yes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, thank you guys so much for joining with me and carrying the load with Don and Terry. Continue to keep them lifted up in prayer. They're such wonderful men and women of God, and we thank God for all of your support. And why don't you take time to tune in tomorrow and join us for another edition of Real Life.
Do you feel lonely, forgotten, afraid? You are never alone. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified because of them. For the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Who is our God? Father to the fatherless, defender of widows. This is God whose dwelling is holy. God places the lonely in families. He sets the prisoners free and gives them joy. Know that your life has a purpose. You have meaning, and you aren't around by accident. I have called you back from the ends of the earth so you can serve me, for I have chosen you and will not throw you away. Don't be afraid, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my victorious right hand. If you ever feel alone, call our prayer lines. We are always here for you. Know that Jesus is with you wherever you are, and you are loved.
Cornerstone Television wishes to thank all our faithful viewers whose consistent prayers and financial support have made this program possible.